Hello, everyone, and welcome to tonight's webinar. I'm Dr. Gary Severance with Henry Schein, Executive Leader of Professional Services. Tonight, we've got an exceptional webinar, exceptional speaker, Dr. Richard Sullivan, goes by Sully Sullivan, and I found out why, because there's like four other Richard Sullivans in his family. He's the fourth, a fifth generation dentist, practices out of Brentwood, Tennessee. And what I love about him is he combines practical information, business information, and clinical information, which we all need. He also has a phenomenal podcast and Instagram account, so you can follow him as well. Tonight's program is being recorded, so next week you'll get a an email and a recording possibility to see it again if you'd like, or share with friends. One thing during this, we want to make this extremely valuable to you. So please, if you can, ask any of the questions you want. But please use the Q&A instead of the chat function. That way we can highlight those. And at the end of the program, we'll answer live with Dr. Sullivan as many as we can. This presentation is or webinar is presented on behalf of Henry Schein Dental. There is no CE, either on demand or live, provided for this program. And with that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Sullivan, who's going to talk about the business and financial considerations of printing. Dr. Sullivan.
Gary, thank you so much. I appreciate it. Hey, everyone. Hope you all are having a fantastic day. We are, I'm literally finishing up the workday over here in Central Time. It's 5 o'clock. So just seated for implant crowns about 25 minutes ago. So it's super good to be with you today and to talk about 3D printing. Really, you know, not alone 3D printing, but frankly, one of the things that I really enjoy discussing from time to time as it regards to all technology is really the financial and business considerations that we do have to take into account. When we look at new technology, trying to really make our way in, not only is it good for our business, can it help grow our business? But what are the things that we're going to have to do once we get that technology to implement it and be successful? So really what we'll touch a little bit today on 3D printing as far as what it is and what we can print. But I do want to focus, you know, the majority of the conversation around the math aspect of it, right? The money aspect of it. And so without further ado, let's jump into it. And please, as Gary mentioned, definitely, you know, either post your questions. I can't see your questions. Gary's seen them. So he'll interrupt me if there's one that's super pertinent, and then we'll have some Q&A at the end. But it's really important to me that we do make some time to answer your questions, because really, at the end of the day, that's why I'm here, is to get those questions answered. So let's jump into it. Who am I? Some of you may know me. I'm a dentist out of Nashville, Tennessee. My name is Sully. I'm very fortunate. I get to work with my dad. It's pretty cool. Most days that I would say that. I'm actually a fourth generation dentist, which is also cool. So my granddad actually started this practice. We are now three doctors, four hygienists out of this little 2,700 square foot office, and it is crazy. I meant to get a picture before. I have to snag one and add it. But currently, our 3D printers and wash machine and curing unit are actually in our team bathroom. So literally, you can go to the restroom and get a model out of the tank, you know, at the base at the same time. So it's pretty funny. We're actually currently building a really nice new facility that we're excited about. But yeah, that's a little bit about us. PPO practice. I think that is important because, you know, the dentistry I do and the type of dentistry that we do has to function and work in a, you know, PPO environment. We're not some fancy fee for service, you know, practice where I only see four patients a day. I mean, you know, inevitably we see, you know, 50 to 60 patients a day when you consider hygiene and the three doctors, et cetera. So the technology we utilize has to work in that kind of environment. These are the three printers that I actually own personally. The Moonray printer, actually, I'll start with Form Labs. The Form 2 was actually the first printer that I ever got about 4 years ago. And then we did some minor printing on it, mainly models and stuff like that. Honestly, I didn't have a lot of success at that point. We'll talk about why I didn't have some success as we get into kind of the further parts of the presentation. But it wasn't necessarily the printer. It was the mindset around printing that I think is important that we discuss, and understanding the importance and, you know, criticalness really of how you're getting your design of the things you're printing, where you're designing yourself. Kind of going along my printing journey, I then got the Moonray printer. I was like, okay, I want to see what all this Sprint Ray stuff's about. And it was a great printer. And then when the Sprint Ray Pro came out, I upgraded to that. And I'm hopefully going to be getting a 55 here soon. We just literally have nowhere to put it in our current space. It's nice because I have gotten to use a number of different printers, and I've had some experience playing around with some of the other companies. There really are a lot of players on the market. You know, when we look at printers by and large, there's probably six or seven, you know, major players within the dental market now. These two to me have been kind of my favorites to work with for a couple of reasons. One is they are dental focused, which, yes, at the end of the day, 3D printing doesn't matter whether it's for dentistry or not. 3D printing is the same, but it does matter from the support side of things. And, you know, one of the things that specifically I love that Sprint Ray's done is they're constantly trying to complete the circle. So, and that'll make more sense when we get into kind of the, what I consider the four steps of being successful at printing. But you're going to find that the printing part is really the easy part. The money to the, you know, the financial aspect of this, the business aspect of printing, the printing's the easy part. It's kind of the stuff that goes around printing that really can play a role in that. So I want to mention this. I think it's interesting. I actually literally just wrote this article for Dental Economics back in March. They did a whole thing on 3D printing, and the title of my article was 3D printing, the technology of now. To me, this is a big year for 3D printing. Now, yes, we've had printing for a long time. Really in dentistry, probably at least 4 or 5 years now we've used it. But for the most part, it was really kind of the early adopters that were doing it. Most of y'all have probably seen this kind of a graph used to kind of explain or show technology. And it's all about how technology integrates into the market. So for the most part, the last couple of years, I think we've really been in the early market where we see it on Instagram, we see it on Facebook. We can print things, but we can't necessarily do it on a large scale. Frankly, a scale that makes financial and business sense. It's more of just like kind of fun that we can print toys and print models. And really, what the focus of the article I wrote was on is that I think we have crossed the chasm. We're now to that point where the technology's here. We've got the printers. We've got the speed of printing. We've got the materials. I mean, we can print really nice night guards, really nice dentures, nice surgical guides. We're really close to being able to start to print restorations that are similar to, an Empress or Feldspathic ceramic. You know, we're getting closer to being able to print more permanent type restorations. So we've crossed this chasm of where, to me, 2021 really is the time to invest in 3D printing. It's going to at some point be that you're now behind on that level. And the nice part, which is unique for us normally, is that the point of entry isn't crazy. You know, when you look at to get into 3D printing, you're really looking at somewhere between, I think, roughly $6,000 to $8,000, maybe a little more, depending on what kind of printer you get. But where we're used to $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 scanners, expensive mills, cone beam CT. So on technology side, it's really not that hard. It's not that bad of an entry point. The other reason I think we've kind of crossed this chasm into it's now time to really 3D print is because we've actually got easy and predictable ways to get designs. And you're going to hear me talk about designs a lot today, because to me, that's the most challenging part of being successful in printing. So what do I mean by designs? Well, for instance, if you want a night guard, someone has to design this night guard, right? And the best way to think about 3D printing is you are becoming your own lab, right? So those of you that have Cerac or Plan Mecca or used to milling restorations in your office, this is an unbelievably easy breeze because you're used to this concept and idea that, hey, my assistants are going to be, doing lab work. They're going to be staining, glazing crowns, preparing things and getting ready. That's really how this has to be treated. So for, say, a night guard, for example, if you're doing this in an analog approach, you're going to send them an upper impression, a lower impression, and a bite. You send that to the lab, they make the night guard, they send it back, and you get it. Whereas now you're doing the same thing. You're taking your upper impression, your low impression, your bite, but now you're moving it into some sort of software or sending it somewhere in which case you're going to get a digital file back or create a digital file yourself, and now you're going to go print this. So getting that digital file has been the, in my opinion, the main reason that people have held back from jumping into the pool. And that's what I'm most excited to share with you today is we are there. We've got good ways to get designs, which ultimately to me means that we're going to see, especially, you know, I think this year that 3D printing really does move into the mainstream market. Okay. So two questions to kind of ask as it pertains really to the financial considerations of things. One is, what can we print? You know, what in dentistry can we print? And then number two, following up on that same question, is does printing those things make any sense? You know, it's there's a lot of things we can do. It doesn't necessarily make sense that we want to do them. I could walk, you know, to work every day, but I choose to drive a truck, you know? So we can do a lot of things, but it doesn't make financial sense. So we'll talk about that. So first off, what can we print? Models is the number one thing that we print most often in our office. The other things we can print on a day-to-day basis are surgical guides, night guards, and then dentures. Now, the one that's not on here that we're going to be seeing more and more and more is when we get into crown and bridge. I'm now printing shell temporaries for big veneer cases. We can actually, you know, scan and then design and print temporaries just like we would print restorations. So we really can do a number of things from a crown and bridge standpoint to night guards, to dentures, and surgical guides. Now, the one that makes the most financial sense, believe it or not, is models. You know, and people, it's not the most flashy thing, but I think it's the one that we use the most often, right? I mean, whether it's for retainers, diagnostic wax ups, mock-ups for aesthetics, for temporaries, for a number of different things. And it's the thing we print the most often. So I tell people that really, in my opinion, the first place to start is with models. It's the most common thing to print. It's easy to print. And it helps us get past that design part because basically there is no design. You just print the model. We'll get into these other ones as we kind of get into the presentation. But models is definitely the one that I tend to, you know, at least lean on people getting into. And the nice thing is all of us need that, right? I mean, the other ones, you may or may not do them, but everybody's printing models. Does it make sense? We're going to look at those individually to kind of tell you, you know, basically my pros and cons to printing these things. So very quickly, I want to give you a little idea of the difference between the sprint ray printers and the Formlab printers. The big difference is that the sprint ray printers are a DLP printer, which means digital light projection. And so it's actually projecting an image onto the build platform where those models are hanging. So the way it cures things is in layer by layer by layer. So what's nice about that is the time in which it takes to print something is only basically controlled by the height of the object. So if something's really tall, it's going to take a long time to print. If it's short, like a model, surgical guide, et cetera, laying flat, it can be printed in, you know, 17 to 20 minutes on some cases. SLA printers, they take a little longer to print because they are moving a dot side to side. This next image really shows you. So the one on the left is actually the Formlabs. It's like tracing the lines of where it's going. So what that means basically is that it can print, it may have a tall object that it could print fast if it's tall and skinny. Whereas the other printer, the DLP printer, it's projecting that whole image of squares at one time. So, and because of that, you can get a little tighter pixel size so that the accuracy can be slightly better, you know, depending on what you're working with there. And here's a little bit of the finish that you would then kind of see on the SLA printers versus the DLP printers. Now, when we talk about kind of micron size and whatnot and getting into more of the details, we know now that the sprint rays come out with the Sprint Ray Pro 55, and the 95 and the 55 are basically in reference to that size. So up until this year, the 55 really hasn't been needed or was desired at all, because for the most part, what we were doing was all accomplished with that 95 micron size. Whereas now when we start to actually get into the idea of conceptually that we're going to start printing permanent restorations, crowns, onlays, inlays, that sort of thing, veneers, we now need something that can print with a little higher precision and accuracy. And so that's why the 55 was kind of brought to market. So when you're looking at kind of these two printers specifically, it's a super common question of which one do I go with? The white one, the 55 on the right, is a little more precise in that regard. However, it has a much smaller build platform, so you can't print as much on it at one time. The 95 on the left has a much bigger platform, but again, isn't quite as detailed as the 55 is. Now, we're printing temporaries. I've probably printed over 1,000 surgical guides, and there's no issues with fit and accuracy on the 95 side. It's just when we start to get into kind of looking at more permanent restorations and those type of things. So the deciding factor financially for me when it comes to this is what are you interested in printing? Because if you're interested in printing, you know, something like aligners, where that's a lot of models, kind of like they have stacked on the platform on the left, then in that case, you're probably better off with the 95 than the 55, unless you're wanting to, you're someone who's like, hey, I'm getting this thing because I want to print long-term restorations or, you know, really nice temporaries, and that's kind of my main resource. And then I think the 55 makes some sense. Or if you're not worried about stacking a platform, then the 55 obviously could accomplish all the needs that you have. It just has that smaller platform. So if you're interested in printing a lot at once, that would be the negative to that printer. Okay, so I actually get the pleasure of getting to teach a 3D printing course in Raleigh at 3D Dentist. And I think we've done a nice job of kind of breaking printing down into this four-step workflow. And we'll briefly talk about it today because this is really where we start to impact and see the financial considerations that we have to deal with. But I like to break it down and from capture, how do we get these images that we're going to do something with? Design, what do we do with them once we have them? Print, obviously, you know, we're actually the process of printing. And then finally, how are we post-processing things and what does that look like? So we'll kind of run through this four-step workflow now. All right, so capturing. So the first thing we have to do is we've got to get the images of teeth out of our scanners, out of wherever they are, and into a file that we can work with. For those of you that don't know, that file is an STL file. It's the universal file that can be 3D printed. And there's really two big things that we have to look at. One is, what scanner should I get? Or, you know, if you don't have a scanner, need a scanner. And then typically the second thing is, you know, is how do we navigate a good scan, or what does a good scan look like in order to do something with it from a 3D printing standpoint? So let's talk about scanners. In my office, we've got two Prime scans and an iTero currently. And we're looking at kind of expanding to more scanners as we continue to grow our practice. Obviously, the Trios is a great scanner. The Medit's a good scanner. You know, Plan Mecca has a nice scanner. The Emerald. There's a lot of different scanners out there on the market. This, to me, is kind of the bigger financial step than the 3D printing itself. Because if you don't have a scanner, it's difficult to be successful at 3D printing. We're looking at, you know, the only way at that point would be to buy a desktop scanner. That's what the image is in the upper right. Or to send your models to a lab who then would convert that into a digital file and then send it back to you. So if you truly want to be successful with 3D printing, you've got to have an intraoral scanner. So that to me is kind of step one of, you know, everybody's 3D printing. I want to do that. How do I get involved? What does it look like? Well, you're going to have to navigate which scanner to get to. To my knowledge, every scanner on the market now exports STL files of models. So there's not necessarily one that's better or worse. That's a whole nother conversation in its own right. They're all really good scanners at this point, frankly. And but that is kind of the first step that you're going to need, is to have a scanner to get into printing. So once we've talked about that, once you've gotten your scanner and you've gotten your files, now we get into design. And this is, like I said, this is really to me where the difficult decisions come in and the money starts to play into effect. So let's talk about design. you essentially have two options when we look at design. You've got third-party design, which means sending everything out. They send you back a file, and then you print it. And then you have in-house designs. To me, the talking points, if you will, are time, control, and convenience. Now, what I encourage everyone to do and to start with is to utilize third-party designs. Printing is, whenever you bring printing into an office, it's new for the team. And anything new for the team can create its own challenges, right? And I'm a huge believer that time is our most valuable asset. And the trickle down from that time is that my team is their time is their most valuable asset. So, you know, if I could be prepping crowns, I don't need to be putting resin in the tank to print. You know, if my team member could be, closing big cases, you know, they don't necessarily need to be designing a night guard. So the challenge here is really laying out a success path to these different procedures and trying to figure out what makes the most sense from a business standpoint. Because to me, this is where it really, really starts to get into, okay, this isn't about printing. It's about how do we make this work financially? So what I tell everyone is that you should start with third-party designs. So let's take a night guard, for example. In order to get a night guard to 3D print it, you can take a digital impression of the upper, lower, and the bite. There are now companies, SprintRay being one of them, that have a dashboard built into their system where you can upload those files, and within 48 hours, they'll have a digital design in an STL file of a night guard for, I think, $25. So to me, that's a pretty solid way to get your design in a relative short period. Now, everything has a learning curve, right? So there's the learning curve of how do I get into printing, meaning like getting the printer, et cetera. There's a learning curve for your team and how do I run the printer? How do I post-process stuff? And so when you get started, I think that eliminating the design as much as you can, farming that out to a third party, makes the most sense. At what point your team gets comfortable with the design, with the printing and the post-processing, you're doing 30 night guards a month, now it kind of makes sense to have that conversation or look at, should we bring that in-house to design? Because the next thing is really the next two things, control and convenience. And control and convenience for me are the reasons why in-house designing is important, right? Because surgical guides, for one, is the one that I don't farm out. I do all my own surgical design myself. And the reason that I do that is because I want control. I don't want to have to send that off to somebody, then have to remote in, design on my computer, or show me where I can't grab the mouse and move the implant. So that's one for me that like I want to bring in-house. And secondly to that is convenience. I had a patient this week, came in on Tuesday, and he's got like six remaining teeth up front, and we're going to take those teeth out and end up putting five or six implants for a fixed hybrid. So we do block scheduling pretty seriously, and I had a big block on this coming Monday open for a big surgery appointment. Now, if I was farming this out, there's a likelihood that I may not be able to get on the schedule, get it designed, get the file back, and get it printed in time. But because I'm doing the design, I now can turn this around in 24 hours or print it this weekend and do the design myself so that now I can make it happen. So to me, that's a good instance of, okay, hey, it's very convenient to design it myself. We'll talk individually about these when we get specifically to each thing that we can print, but this becomes the overarching theme of, okay, does it make, how much of a time suck is it? How much control do I gain? And is it convenient enough to print it in-house versus utilizing these third-party companies? So be thinking about that. Kind of continuing through the workflow, once you've gotten the design, then it's all about printing. And like I said, to me, the economics of this really become down to you've got to empower a team member to do it. I'm a huge believer in 3D printing being team driven. Andrea is my 3D printing champion. She does all of our 3D printing work. I don't really even know, you know, it's probably been a minute since I like changed the resin or put a print on the printer. You know, it all gets farmed out to her and she makes sure that things get done in their place. So there is a learning curve there. And in order to be successful, in my opinion, this has to be trained to where a team member really owns it and takes on kind of ownership of that. And so they become your lab person. Now, the financial impact to us doctors in that regard is now we've got to either hire an additional person to do this or replace them or give them time. So when we first started printing, back when I just had my Form 2, the main challenge I had was I didn't have good ways to get designs. So we printed a lot of models, but I wasn't doing surgical guides myself at that point. So I just ended up freehanding things because I didn't want to wait on it or remote in. I mean, I was lazy, frankly. There weren't good night guard designs. Aligners wasn't, there weren't good design things for that. So like the design's really what held me up. The next thing that held me up was trying to do all of it myself and not get a team member to kind of take ownership of it so that I no longer had to do it. And then once I finally did do that, what hurt me was I wasn't giving Andrea enough time to actually work on it. So that wasn't working because next thing I know, she's, you know, working through lunch or staying late, trying to get things printed because I haven't taken the time to, you know, allocate her time during the day to be my lab, because essentially that's what she was acting like in that regard. For those of you that don't know, when you look at the printer, it's really super straightforward. All these printers, no matter what you have a build platform. That's what's the top right of the screen, and a resin tank. That's what's in the bottom right of the screen. The resin goes in the resin tank, and whatever you're printing is going to attach to that build platform, like you see the models and the image on the left. So the build platform goes up and down, up and down, up and down, and cures each layer one at a time. And that's kind of how printing works. So it goes just like that for like 30 minutes. This is what Rayware looks like. All these printers come with their own software. Rayware is the software for SprintRay, where we do the design. Where we load things onto the build platform and get them ready to print. Again, this is something that we farm all out to our team members. Doctors, you shouldn't be doing this. To me, that's one of the biggest reasons that, or one of the most business-like successful things you can do is farm this out to a team member in your office that's doing the printing for you. Here's a surgical guide. It's as simple as dropping it into the screen, importing it in. Surgical guides, we print upside down. So I flipped it over. I generate supports so that it has something to print because it's an uneven surface. And literally I hit the green button over on the right and print it. So it's super straightforward on basically the ease of getting into the printer. Now, the fourth and final step in the workflow is process. So this is something to also take into consideration that a lot of people don't think about. You got to capture it. That should be team driven. They're getting the images, hopefully. Design, we start with a third party. Then maybe you take ownership of it or a team member starts to take ownership. Printing, the team member should be doing. And fourth and finally, the post-processing, team members should be doing. And when we get to that, I actually like to break that down into a four-step process. So every time something's printed, we have to wash it. There's excess resin that's liquidy and gooey that's on the things we're printing. Now, as you can see in the top left corner, up until just recently, this has been our approach to having to wash this stuff. It's frankly been a pain in the butt. If I had a dollar every time that alcohol has spilled over in our bathroom, I could buy a couple printers. So now, thankfully, we have the new SprintRay wash, which has, I know for some people listening, they maybe have ordered it and they're like, yeah, I've ordered it, I'm ready for it. I promise you it is coming, and it is as described. This thing has been absolutely awesome. You load the alcohol in the right. The build platform fits perfectly in the top portion. You literally press a button and in a 10-minute cycle, it's cleaned it all and dried it. So it really, really is cool. And so that's become now my replacement for the wash, which to me, that alone has been a game changer in the post-processing workflow. Once it's been taken out of the wash and dried, then we have to cure it. Most of these things, it's about a 10-minute curing cycle. Night guards do take about 45 minutes to cure, and then denture materials and the crown and bridge materials, some of them take 45 minutes to an hour to cure. So it just depends on what that material is. And, you know, we started out using nail curing lights, but the challenge is that was when we were only really using one or two different resins. You know, now we've got all these different resins from different companies with different profiles and different characteristics. And so I do think it's somewhat important to be, not somewhat, I think it's important to be curing them at the right times so that you know you're getting the right shrinkage from, you know, what's happening post-curing. The bottom two, finish and polish, really these are individually specific to different workflows. We'll go over those shortly. But, you know, models have basically no finishing and polishing, whereas, you know, dentures and aligners and stuff like that, those have much more finishing and polishing steps. So jumping back here, that kind of concludes the overall vision of 3D printing, of how do we be successful with 3D printing? There's four steps: capture, design, print, and process. Again, my goal for people to be successful, and I think why we're successful printing, is that it's completely team driven. Yes, there's on occasion we may scan, but you know, for night guards, retainers, mock-ups, all that's probably happening in hygiene, being scanned by our hygienist. Surgical guides, some night guards, denture scans, for, you know, even aligners, that could be assistants. But routinely, I'm not having anything to do with the capture process. Design, we'll talk about that in a second more with the others, but getting the design is important. And then finally, the last two, print and process, as I mentioned, those are also should be completely team driven. Really, doctors, we shouldn't be involved in this step in a very minimal way. Jump back ahead. Okay. So now I want to, you know, spend basically the next, you know, 15, 20 minutes or so before we kind of go through some questions, just going through each of these different things that we're printing in our office and talk about the pros and cons and the financial benefits and not so benefits to each of them, if you will. All right, models. So models, again, to me is it doesn't have all the flashy stuff, but it's the most go-to thing that you can print. We're printing models literally every single day in our office. Study models for aligners, retainers, temporaries, prepped models to mill restorations and then polish them on. To me, this is the number one starting point to do it. You know, when you look at the financial savings, to me, where it's great is, one, patients don't like impression material, right? So if you've got an intraoral scanner, you know this. Now I get to complete that. I no longer have to, you know, pour up stone. You know, we don't even have a stone mixer or anything like that. You know, we're not even putting that kind of stuff in our new building because it's all being, you know, printed and handled from that standpoint. The nice thing about models is there's zero design. You know, you're exporting it from your scanner, importing it to print, and then the show goes on. So there's no, you kind of skip that big step of, or hurdle of design. And so to me, if the only reason to get a printer was for models, it's worth it. You know, what we do, kind of our workflow now, which has been really nice, is we've got a big a hard drive that's on our server. So all the computers access it. That's just a huge hard drive that's dedicated to the patient's images, meaning like intro, like clinical photography. So we take a lot of full face photos, retracted smile, full arch photos to discuss with patients. And then we also store their models there. So now I've got a digital catalog of, you know, 2,000-3,000 patients where you go to Sully Sullivan, you've got your photos from, you know, April 20th, and then you've got your upper and lower STL files of the of their arches on April 20th. So now I've got this digital record. And then if we ever make night guard for those patients or retainers, we save that file in there. So now I've got this digital, you know, library of information that I can either reprint, reuse, and keep for without having to have store this all in person. So that's really, really nice. And it's been a good way to store that stuff. All right. Surgical guides is my personal number two favorite thing to print in the office. Obviously, this is going to be dependent on whether you're placing implants or you're not. If you are placing implants, I hope you are considering or doing guided surgery. I started placing, you know, the majority of my implants freehanded because that's just how I learn. And over the past 2 years, I've pretty much committed to pretty much 90-95% of my cases now are guided. And the big reason, again, is that I now can bring that design in-house. So when we look at surgical guides, kind of going through the four-step workflow, capturing is the same as everything else. I need an upper and a lower. You know, if I'm taking tooth number 14, I really just need that quadrant of where I'm going to put the implant. Design. Obviously, you can third-party this out. Most labs will do a design for you, and you can pay them, and they will send you a file that you can print. I started doing my design using Blue Sky Bio and Blue Sky Plan, and that's worked pretty well. But I've recently just switched to using ExoCAD and ExoPlan, and I'm really liking that a lot more. And to me, this starts to get into, okay, where are we going, right? So from a design standpoint, once you start to bring in design, like we have in our office, I now want to have a trajectory where I can bring almost everything. Because my philosophy is that with the rate 3D printing's going, from materials, from a software standpoint, there's really no reason that we almost don't have an in-office designer in our office within 2-3 years. And so at that point, I want a software that's robust enough to handle a lot of that. So the nice thing about Blue Sky Bio is that it's free. You do have to pay for each thing, and it's limited for the most part to surgical guides, some aligner stuff, and some minor denture stuff, but there's not really a good night guard module. And that was kind of important to me. So by switching to ExoCAD and ExoPlan, now it's a much more expensive upfront cost, but I now don't have to pay for anything on a daily visit. And I'm using the same software for mockups, night guards, aligners, dentures, surgical guides, everything. So that's one reason that we kind of switched to that. But if you're getting started, and you want something just to play around with, Blue Sky Bio would be the entry point, I guess, to consider. Once you've gotten your guide designed, then it's just as simple as handing it off to your team member, letting them print it and post-process it. So again, the design part really does come into play here is, okay, how do we get that design? You know, what's your time worth? And what's the convenience in your level to control it? The control part's a big one for me, and why I initially brought, you know, surgical guides into the practice to print. Here's just a little case, kind of, again, why I think guided's important. This lady's missing all of her posterior teeth on her upper right. So we're going to design a guide for 3 implants. This is actually back when I was using my Form 2 more. There's the guide designed. There are our 3 implants placed guided. There they are. You know, keeping with the digital philosophy, we have CERAC. And so here's our digital impression posts. And then there are 3 EMAX screw retain crowns. So, you know, pretty cool. That would be a super hard case to freehand to get 3 screw retain crowns. Why 3 instead of a bridge? I don't know. I like to floss, so that's what I went with. All right, dentures. Now we're starting to get kind of into the fun stuff. This is the stuff that I really like to kind of do in our office. So we actually are printing all of our dentures now. I'll preface that with, we don't do a lot of final dentures, meaning all my dentures are typically based around implants, meaning hybrids or locators, snap-ins. And so we haven't really gotten to the point where we're using these as a long-term final solution. We're using them as immediate dentures, which they work really well for. And we're using them for all of our immediate conversions and our temporaries during hybrid process before they get their final material. So we've had a lot of success with them being, you know, in similar in strength, I guess, to like a PMMA, where I haven't had issues with people breaking them and whatnot. So we're converting them just like we would an acrylic denture. And again, the part for me that's so nice about this is convenience. The guy that's coming in on Monday that I told you about earlier, from a guide standpoint, we got his denture designed. Dentca Design is the one that I use for design, Dentca, D-E-N-T-C-A. And for $30, they'll design you a denture file. I think for $20, they have an online cloud-based software where you can design it yourself. And we'll have, so I sent that on Tuesday, got the denture back today, printing it tomorrow, and we'll have the denture ready to convert for Monday's surgery. You can do these in two different ways. One as one solid piece, like the picture on the right, and then you can paint on the gingiva with composite or different resins, or you can print them in two different resins, like the ones on kind of the upper left. You print in denture base, and then you print in tooth color material. Personally, I really, really like printing in the tooth color material, like the ones on the right, for a couple of reasons. One, financially, I only now have to stock one resin. I don't have to worry about stocking the pink resin. I think we can get a little nicer characterization with the resins and the composites when you paint them on or add them on. I think Andrea's dentures that she does looks a little nicer when she does it that way. And finally, strength. It's one solid piece versus the junction between the teeth and the denture. So I'm typically doing all my dentures like that from that standpoint. So again, looking at kind of the business side of this, the challenge here has always been design. You know, you can get these scans, and the scanners now are pretty good at getting them. It's how do I get a denture design? And I've just been blown away and thrilled with the designs that I've gotten from Dentca. Again, $30 for a denture design within 48 hours. It's just hard to beat that. You know, I'm like, I'm sure I could learn to do it, but I'd rather go, you know, play with my kid or anything from that standpoint. So yeah. So again, third party versus in-house. I'm third partying this out. So recapping so far, models, there's no design. Surgical guides, we design in-house now using Exocad, Exoplan. We used to use Blue Sky Bio. Dentures, we use Dentca. They've got a third party and in-house option basically, but for $30, it's hard to beat the third party option. So and then again, once you print it, and there's more post-processing here. So that does bring me to my kind of next point as we get into these other things, is dentures, night guards, and aligners all have more post-processing. You don't just take it out, cure it, wash it, and use it. So this is where you've got to start to allocate more time to a team member and give them the opportunity to kind of learn and get them what they need. Andrea came to me this week, actually, and she had seen some composite that a lab was using on Facebook. And she's like, hey, I think we really, you know, need this composite to make these things look a little nicer and polish them up. So I was like, sure. So, you know, we're just getting her what she needs to be successful, basically, is really important. But I don't have any role in this. I mean, it'll be here. It'll be great. Okay, let's talk night guards. So I imagine that this is specifically one that probably a lot of people are interested in. You know, second to models, this is the most common thing that probably every practice on some level does. We print these night guards on rafts. That's what attaches them to the platform. That's these kind of chunky parts that are attached to them. That makes it really easy for cleanup and post-processing. The resin we are using is Key Splint Soft resin from Keystone. there are a number of other different splint resins, but I think universally what you'll see kind of across the board is that those of us that are having a lot of success with night guards, we're using this key splint soft resin. It's got a nice flexible kind of give to it, but it's still a hard night guard. So it's not rigid and brittle like some of the surgical guide resins that and other resins that are more likely to break or snap or frankly just aren't comfortable. Kind of looking again through workflow, walking through the 4-step workflow. Capture, just as simple as everything else, upper, lower bite. I will point out and say I really encourage people to get their bite using a leaf gauge or something that kind of helps them get the bite in a more accurate bite from where the night guard will be, not a maximum intercuspation bite, so to speak. Reason being that, you know, when you get into designing your own, you realize how much you have to open these people up. And it's just a lot easier from a design standpoint if they're already opened up to the right spacing that you need. So looking at night guard design, once you've gotten the capture, there's really a couple of different ways that you can get your designs. One is if you got a sprint ray printer, you're crazy not to try out their dashboard and their night guard design team. They're pretty limited. They'll do a flat plane and an anterior ramp, I believe, which obviously covered the most things. But they charge $25 for the night guard design. And it's, I think, a 48-hour turnaround, like maximum. And usually they're within 24 hours. So that's a really, really nice way to start to get into design. There are a number of other companies as well out there that do night guard design. Your own lab may even do it for you. So you just need to reach out. The in-house design options are basically, there's D3 splint, which is a super common one people talk about. D3 splint is kind of more of like a beta software. It kind of looks more beta-y and it's constantly evolving. And it's a nice software that I started with doing my design. But now, again, just from a kind of a standardization of things, we've moved into exocad and using exocad to do all of our night guard designs. And part of that's just because the workflows in one program, it's nice. Things as simple as just which buttons to click. They're all the same versus when you get four different softwares, you're trying to remember, okay, what is the left click doing this one and the right click doing that one? And so it's been helpful for us to kind of streamline thing into one platform. Continuing through that workflow, after you've gotten your design, we're now looking at printing it and post-processing it. There's the minimal post-processing here, cleaning up the raft and then polishing it and getting it ready to deliver. So from an overall cost standpoint, you know, you can easily get a night guard if you're using a third-party design for somewhere between, you know, $30 and $40 in material costs and design. All right. Finally, the last but not least is aligners. Aligners are a tricky one, you know, and it's one a lot of people want to do, and we do some of it. But aligner, the challenge with aligners is it's the most time consuming of all of the different applications we can use from a post processing standpoint. At its core, all we're doing is printing models, right? We can't print the aligner. And I think this is really, really an important thing that I want to, like, you know, leave y'all on, is that when we look at aligners, it does take a lot of time. So let's go through our 4-step workflow. We got to capture it. No problem. Super easy. We get to design. One, now we got to design these movements. One option is you use a third-party company to do this. There are a number of labs that will get you designs. And they just, you pay for all the models and you just print them and do the vacuum forms on it. That usually is going to run you probably somewhere between, I don't know, $200 and $400 for a case. And then you got to go through the rest of the steps. Your other option is you use an in-house Blue Sky Bio, Exocad, something of that nature, and do it yourself. But now we're talking, okay, more time and whatnot that you have to take up or someone else has to take up. And then once we kind of get through it, so let's assume that we say, okay, hey, for $200, I'm willing to pay someone to do the design movements, have an orthodontist prepare the models, and all I have to do is the printing the models and the vacuum forming. I think that's a pretty decent way to go. You know, if Invisalign or something like that costs $1,200, $1,400, you know, I've got a pretty big margin here I can use to make up. So let's call it $250 for my design. Now I got to print this. That's not a problem. I can stack all these on the printer. They print super fast. But then comes the real work. We got to do, you know, vacuum form all these models with plastic. You know, and if you got an upper and lower, that's 20 movements a piece. That's 40 models that got to be printed. 40 aligners that got to be made and fabricated, you know, doing the vacuum forming, then cutting out the plastic, polishing them down. So you can see where now all of a sudden it almost on some level becomes like a half day job or a full day job for an assistant or a team member to do this. Now, yes, you can, this should be team driven and you could eventually hire someone that they just, this becomes their job. Personally, my philosophy is 10 aligners or less. So if it's 10 aligners or less, I'm comfortable with my team doing this, that it's worth their time to print the models and vacuum form them and cut out the plastic and get them ready. When it goes beyond 10 aligners, in my opinion, that's when I would rather just pay to have them done, you know, by a lab and sent to me. Because I really, really value, you know, not only my time, but the trickle down of that from what I talked about earlier is your team member's time. And so if the team member, because to me, the same team member that I could be teaching how to cut out plastic, I could also potentially be teaching that team member to sell more cases. So what's more valuable? Them saving me, you know, a couple $100 on a case or selling two more $4,000 cases. So that's kind of, I think, the hard one for me with aligners is that at this point, because we can't print the aligner, it's a lot of work. Now, here's the kicker. I know that there's a number of different companies who are very close to being able to print the aligner specifically. At that point, you can just throw out everything I just said out the window. It's now a game changer, and I think we'll all start doing it. Because at this point, even Invisalign or a company like that, they're still doing this on a global scale. You know, they're doing vacuum forming, laser cutting them out. I mean, that's literally how they do it. They don't print the aligners either. So once we're able to actually print the aligners, then I think it's a game changer and we can really, you know, start to move forward with this from that standpoint. As we kind of round home here, this is my team yesterday. We had a big Cinco de Mayo party at my house. Andrea is the pregnant one on the right with the striped shirt on. She's who does all of our 3D printing. She's an absolute rock star. The reason I want to show this photo is it takes a village. And I think our key to success in printing is that this really is team driven. You know, and when you look at everything from just a global standpoint of how we make this work in a run and gun, busy PPO practice, it's that the hygienists know and the assistants know, I got to get these scans. I know what the scans need to look like. I know where to put them so that Andrea knows where to go get them to print them. And then once she's printed them, we got assistants that know how to post-process them, how to use them, how to finish the surgical guides, finish the night guards. So all that really does come into play. And how does this work on a day-to-day, you know, business standpoint? Financially, I think we're there. The cost of entry isn't bad at all. Design services are very affordable. The resins are here and they're not expensive, and we've got a plethora of options for different materials. So in my opinion, it really is the time to kind of jump into the pool of 3D printing. Quick plug, I will, you know, we do teach course. So if you like me or, you know, you want to learn or, you know, we have a good time at 3D Dentist Raleigh. But anyways, we do a hands-on course. It's a two-day course. You have to bring an assistant. We're super big on that because it's, again, we teach a team-driven model. We got one coming up in May, I think one or two spots left. And then we've also got this in July. And I believe we got the whole course now online. So if you can't travel or in a state where, you know, you can't travel because of COVID or something like that, you can check it out. But other than that, that is what I got. I hope you enjoy this presentation. And yeah, any questions, I'm happy. I'm here as long as you need me.
Dr. Sullivan, thank you very much. Great presentation. Covered a lot of information, have some great questions. If we can get right to them, that's great. There is a company that offers something called the permanent crown that they're trying out now. And one of the questions was, can you print crowns and bridges? You made the comment calling them long-term versus maybe permanent. When do you see that being a possibility in real life with dentists?
You know, I think we're there. It's just a matter of how do you want to practice, right? I mean, there are some dentists who use feldspathic materials as long-term permanent materials. They may only use them in the anterior. They may not use them in the posterior, right? So, you know, some people like to use Emax everywhere. Some people prefer zirconia on the posterior. So really, the materials are, they're the challenge we're going to have with printing permanent restorations, because that's the word we all like to use, is that it's just the strength and the polishability and the wearability. So we've got, we can print accurate wise, no issue. That's piece of cake. We're here, we're there. And if you're someone who can get adequate thickness, or you are comfortable with certain levels of materials in certain patients that aren't Bruxers, you know, we're here. It just can't, at this point, it can't be treated like Emax or zirconia and just thrown in there with 0.5 millimeters thickness or a millimeter thickness. They're just not strong enough at this point, in my opinion.
Great. And you have a full CAD-CAM system and teach on that as well. How does it determine? Because with a CAD-CAM system or a print, you can do surgical guides on either. You can do temporaries or high-level quality long-term restorations on both. How do you see yourself going? Or what is
so that's a that is a great question. So this is one that we talk about a lot because, yeah, I have the ability to mill guides with CEREC. I never do it. I print all my guides. You know, the reasoning being is one is cost. The cost to print them is still cheaper. Milling them costs like $60. Two, it's hard on the mills, in my opinion. It takes up my mill from being milled in crowns. And it's loud. Anybody that's milled a guide will tell you it is super loud, annoying. So to me, printing guides is an absolute no-brainer. Wouldn't even consider milling them anymore. Now, on the restoration side, this is where it becomes tricky because I always ask, like my favorite question to ask dentists is, what problem are you trying to solve, right? Like, and so for me, one of the challenges with using 3D printing for permanent restorations is I'm coming from CEREC, right? Where a single crown for me is an hour and a half appointment. It could be an hour if I'm hustling, but I prep, you know, because when we look at the time breakdown, let's just use Emax for an example. That's a 13-minute mill, 12-minute fire, so a 25-minute fabrication process. I can cement it in or bond it in, and there's no other post-processing, and I'm out the door in an hour and a half. The challenge we have with printing is I got to scan it, then I got to use a design software to design it. And then I've got to have a mill, then I got to print it. And then there's the post-processing of the print. So we don't have an end-to-end workflow. So when we look at like night guards, Sprint Ray's helped a lot with being able to, you know, bring in that night guard design so that I've got the end-to-end workflow. But right now it's challenging with printing permanent restorations because if I have a desire to do it same day, it's really not realistic in my opinion right now. And for a dentist who's used to, and his patients used to, same day crowns every day, I've got to get my workflow down to where I can scan it, design it, and print it, and then be out the door in an hour and a half. And we're just not there yet.
Okay. And you showed or discussed the issue of having the wash, which certainly is a big advancement and was a pain before, but with the wash, it cleans it up quite a bit. Do you see that the way most of the materials are going to go, or most of the manufacturers are going to provide automatic?
Oh, I think I'm surprised it's taken this long. I mean, and I think that's just the relative newness of it. I mean, I literally tell people, you know, just for perspective's sake, our course at May, the curriculum's different than the course in February, which is different than the course from back in December, which is different than the course back in August. I mean, literally, we're at a time where materials and all this stuff is changing so fast that, yeah, we've got to get to that point. The wash really expedites things because it's just a pain in the butt otherwise.
Great. You mentioned several materials from different manufacturers. Are all the materials, can they all be used in the different printers, or do you have a list of materials that could be on sprint rays or a list that could be on formwave?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So yes and no. It really depends. There's certain printers that are more open than others. I believe Formlabs, I don't know. The last time I checked, because I had my Form 2, I can't print resins other than their resins. So that was one of the negatives that moved me back over to Sprint Ray. Sprint Ray is open. So it has at least five or six different manufacturers' resin profiles, but it doesn't have all of them. So
they have that in the software? They have the profiles in the software? Okay.
Correct. So like Key Split Soft, right, which is an important resin to me because that's what I make all my night guards. It is, that's a resin that is in Sprint Ray's resin profiles. So like they give you all the information to be successful with it. That's a nice feature in my opinion, because I use basically four different resins. I use Sprint Ray model, Sprint Ray surgical guide. So that's one manufacturer. Key Splint Soft. That's Keystone. That's my night guard resin. Dentka makes my denture resin, the tooth color and the denture base. So that's three. And then Bago is the new one. That's the one that everyone's talking about now, which is kind of the long-term temp or permanent resin that I'm trying that out as well. So that's a couple different manufacturers that, you know, it's nice that I can have a printer that uses
all of them or most.
Yeah. Cause I want to be able to, I want to be able to use the best materials out there.
Yep. Very good. And then you mentioned the aspect with the big hard drive, saving your models. Does that mean you don't have to store your models physically anymore if you have that file and can print them at any time?
Yeah, that's the beauty of it. So the way our workflow is right now is when we do, let's say a retainer, we're going to print a model, a lower model for a permanent retainer. We're going to make the retainer and then we're going to give the patient the model and the retainer. And step one is, hey, if you keep your model and you need a retainer in a couple of years, we'll give you $50 off. You know, we'll give them some discount for the fact that they've already got the model because it's as simple as them coming in, us doing a suck down and we're out the door. The second step of it, in my opinion, is you now save that file digitally on, and the nice thing about like server space in theory is that it's just, when it gets bigger, you just slap on another hard drive. I'm not your IT guy. I don't know how that works, but I think it's possible. So we just keep adding data to this thing to where now we've got, you know, a good bit of all this stuff stored. Like night guards is huge. How many dogs chew night guards and stuff like that? You know, so from like here's a good selling point. We actually sell our night guards in twos. So we raised our fee a little bit. So I think we charge like $850 now for a night guard, instead of like say $500 or $450, but we're doing like you get two because it doesn't cost, the design's the same. The print time's the same. It's just a little more resin, but now I can sell, you know, I'm saying, hey, I can do one night guard for $600 or I'll make you two for $800. What do you want, Gary?
Yeah.
So like, that's a no brainer.
But you're not saving the models in the basement or storage area anymore for that time period. You're either.
Gosh, no.
Yeah. That's beautiful for everybody. Every state that requires that. We are over, people, we've got great questions left and I'm going to make sure I get them to you, Sully, if you wouldn't mind responding. If you didn't think of anything, any question that you wanted to ask and you still want to ask, please email us at webinars@henryschein.com. And remember, we did record this. So one person wants the entire workflow for the 3D printed denture. So he went over that and you'll be able to see that on the repeat as well. So we will get you the link to that viewing as well. So again, webinars@henryschein.com. Please let us know and we'll get any questions to Dr. Sullivan. Sully, have a wonderful night. Hope you get home shortly, see your family, and have a wonderful night. Thank you all for attending.
Thank you all.